lepers were in Israel in the time of Elisha the prophet, and none of them were cleansed, saving who? Naaman the Syrian. Many, but none in the church that were prepared. Can you imagine? It would be like a minister saying today that there are over 17 million Seventh-day Adventists in the church, but not one Seventh-day Adventist is ready for the crisis that's getting ready to take place. You know, if a Seventh-day Adventist said that day, they would stone him right now, just like they did to Jesus. But my brothers and sisters, when you understand what's taking place in the world, you see this is why we have to understand what is the mission of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Question, what is our basic problem? We have lost the sight of our mission. Question, what is our mission? To finish the work. And in order to finish the work, we have to recognize that the regular lines have been bound by chains. Do you know that right now the reason why the truth that is to be presented right now seems so strange is because something has happened to the regular lines of our denomination. Now, what are the regular lines? Watch now. Spiritual chains have been placed upon the church. And right now, we don't know it, but do you know that most of us today in here are chained and we can't get out? These chains must be broken before the work can be finished. Some people are trying to finish the work, but the chains have never been broken. Common people must understand, oh, brother, we'll come back to this. We're laying the foundation. Now, do you know that you here sitting in this room today, that something is going to happen in this camp meeting that's just as surely significant as what happened in the executive camp meeting that started the midnight cry? In the parables which Christ has spoken, it was his purpose both to warn the what? Rulers and to instruct the people who were willing to be taught, but there was what? Now, all throughout Christ's ministry, he had been given parables, giving teaching in parables. But it says that as he came to the end of his ministry, something else had to take place. It says, there was a need to speak, yet how? Now, somebody says, you get in trouble for speaking plainly. Yes, you do. Ask John the Baptist. You know what happened to John the Baptist? He got his head chopped off. You get in trouble for speaking plainly. It says, through their reverence for tradition and their blind faith and a corrupt priesthood, the people were what? Enslaved. And it says, these chains, what? Christ must break. The character of the priests and rulers and Pharisees must be more fully exposed. There has to be some chains that are broken. And in order to do that, there must come some pointed messages. Well, the prophet says, this fearful time just before Christ is to come, the second time, it says God's faithful preachers will have to bear a what? Still more pointed testimony than was borne by John the Baptist. My friends, John the Baptist wasn't talking about some fluff. John the Baptist's message was plain and pointed. And his desire was to reach the hearts of those people. You know why? Listen to me, brothers and sisters. When John the Baptist came on the scene, how much time was left for the Jewish nation? How much time? Talk to me. There were only 7 years left when John the Baptist came on the scene. And so John the Baptist came on the scene trying to prepare the way for Christ because he knew that unless a body was prepared, that all would have been lost. And so John was preaching the message to wake up God's church. And do you know today the church is so sleeping that God says another message of similar character must be born to wake us up. And my brothers and sisters, if you just look around the world today, think of it. Do you know why we have to wake up? You see, we're sitting around praying in churches thinking that everything is life as usual, that every year is a continuation of the year before. Anybody know who that man is right there? Tell me, who is this man right here? That man thought he was the Joker. You know where this man went? Into that theater. You tell him, listen, I'm sure you would have been happy to be a faithful Seventh-day Adventist that day. No, it's serious. We were told not to go down to the theaters. And the devil was trying to prevent Seventh-day Adventists from ever having this happen. Do you know that the prophecy told us that this was going to happen? And that God was preserving Seventh-day Adventists for this? And the world doesn't know it, and Seventh-day Adventists were to be preparing the world to understand this? You know, the prophet says, listen to me, brothers, this is not accidental, it's prophetic, and we're just going to sleep like everything's all right. coming to camp meeting, and we're trying to just take sleeping pills. My brother and sister, I'm not going to take no sleeping pill. We got to wake up. Look what the prophet says, volume 9, page 11. It says, the condition of things in the world shows that troublous times are what? Now look at what the prophet says. This was 100 years ago. Right upon us, the daily papers are what? Full of indications of a terrible conflict. When? In the near future. Bold robberies are of frequent occurrence. Strikes are what? Are common. Thefts and murders are committed on every hand. Men possessed of. You better understand something. This man was possessed of a demon. You know, when they asked this man, listen what it says. It says, men possessed of demons are taking the lives of three people. What does it say? Men. What happened in that theater? Men, women, and little children's lives. This man was possessed with a demon. Now, my brothers and my sisters, listen to me. When this man was asked, why did he do it? He said he doesn't know why he did it. There was no cause. He was possessed of a demon. And men have become infatuated with vice and every species of evil. And we'll look at this man and say how terrible he was. But do you know that many of us have some of the same demons? You go read about the demoniacs in Luke 4. You go about read about the man in the temple. It said that the Pharisees had the same demon, but it was just polished and a suit was put on. Look what the prophet says. The agencies of evil are combining their forces, are consolidating, they are strengthening for the last great crisis. Great changes are soon to take place in our world, and the final movements will be what? This is going on right now. Men, women, and little children's lives are being taken. And do you know what happened when this took place? Did they put the details on the news? Everywhere you turn, CNN, everywhere you turn on the news, they put the details in full array, and many kept watching and reading. But do you know what the prophet said about that? Look what she says in Great Controversy. Great Controversy 585, it says, the whole system of religious principles and doctrines, which should form the foundation and framework of social life, seems to be a what? Is that right now? The social fabric of society seems like it's unraveling. It says, ready to fall to ruin, the vilest of criminals. I mean, think about the man just the other day. Over there in Canada, I believe it was. That man took that other part and cut off the different parts of the body and sent it to the political offices. Over in Canada, transvestite. Got over there and cut the man's body up and sent it to different parts of the world. How can you wonder if the Holy Spirit has been withdrawn from this earth? And it says, the vilest of criminals. Now, do you know what happened? You know how they caught him? This brother went over and got him to Europe. He said he had never visited, and then started going to the internet, seeing how many people were watching him on the news. It says, the vilest of criminals who were thrown into prison for their offenses are often made the recipients of what? Gifts and attentions, as if they have attained and what? Enviable distinction. Great, now this is 100 years ago, brothers and sisters. Great, how can we wonder this is a prophet? Great publicity is given to their character and crimes. The press does what? Publishes the revolting details of vice. Now notice what it does. As it publishes the details, what happens? What does initiating mean? Do you know what? It says, thus initiating others. Do you know that immediately after this joker came down here and did what he did? Do you know that immediately after him, another man came and said he's going to do worse than that man? But he told the boss, and the boss told the police, and they came over, found over 25 type of weapons in the man's house with explosives enough to have taken out almost that whole city. And you telling me that we're going to go around here telling us it's all right and that all we have to do is just be all right with everybody? My friends, listen, we better wake up. A crisis is here. We're not ready. It says, thus initiating others into the practice of fraud, robbery, and even what? Murder. and Satan exalts in the success of his hellish schemes. Let me tell you something. It's not over yet. We're getting ready to see worse than that. Everything is taking place just as the prophet said, a time of trouble such as never was. Now, my brothers and sisters, this is going on right now. We won't look at it now. You know that. The mass shooting took place. We won't look at the details of it. But my friends, if this is going on now, we must understand, we need to know, what does it mean to finish the work? What is the work that needs to be finished? You need to ask yourself that question. How will this work be finished? You need to ask yourself the question, what is the work? How will it be finished? But my friends, you can never understand this work until you understand something about the plan of redemption. Go on your Bibles to Luke chapter 21. What book did I say? Luke chapter 21, I want you to notice what the Bible says in Luke, the 21st chapter. Luke chapter 21, beginning in verses, Luke 21, beginning in verse 24. Luke 21, beginning in verse 24, let me know when you get there by saying amen. Luke 21, verse 24. And I want you to see that all these events are only understood in light of the plan of redemption. In Luke 21, beginning in verses 24, the Bible says, Luke 21, beginning in verse 24, the Bible says, and they shall fall by the edge of the sword, and shall be led away captive into all nations. And Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles until the time of the Gentiles be fulfilled. Verse 25, and there shall be what? Signs in the sun, and in the moon, and in the stars, and upon the earth distress of nations with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring, men's heart failing them for fear, and for looking after those things which are coming upon the earth, for the powers of heaven shall be what? Shall be shaken. And then in verse 28, when the Bible says all these end time signs taking place, all of these signs going on right now, verse 28 says, and when these things what? Begin to come to pass, then do what? Look up. Why? For your redemption draweth nigh. All of this is bringing us to the end of the plan of redemption. Look what the prophet says. This is a quotation that needs to be repeated again and again until it's indelibly impressed upon our minds. In Education 125, 126, it says, the central theme of what? The Bible. The theme about which every other in the whole book clusters is what plan? The redemption plan. It says that the redemption plan is the central theme of the entire Bible. It says the restoration in the human soul of the image of God from the first intimation of hope. You know what that intimation of hope is. What text in the Bible tells us of that intimation of hope? Genesis 3:15. From the first intimation of hope, and the sin is pronounced in Eden, to the last glorious promise of the revelation in Revelation 22:4, that we should see his face, it says that the burden of how much? Every book and every passage of the Bible is the unfolding of this wondrous theme. What is the wondrous theme that is unfolding? The plan of redemption. It says that every chapter, every verse, every book is the unfolding of this wondrous, wonderful plan of redemption. Now, do you know that the majority of people today say, I understand the plan of redemption, but do you know we don't really understand the plan of redemption as we should? In fact, this says that if we really understood it, it says he who understands it, this thought has before him a what? Infinite field for study. He has the, now what do you do with the key? Oh, that key unlocks something. It says he has the key that will unlock to him how much? The whole treasure house of God's word. Do you know that the Bible will never open up and unlock to us until we understand the plan of redemption? We'll never understand how to finish the work until we understand the plan of redemption. And when we see these things, the Bible says, look up, for your redemption does what? It draws nigh. We know that the sanctuary was given to understand this plan of redemption. But now, my brothers and my sisters, I want you to ask you a question right here. Go with me to Genesis 3:15 in your Bible. What book did I say? In Genesis 3:15, I want us to notice something very clearly. In Genesis, the third chapter. In Genesis 3, beginning in verse 15. I want us to read this together. The first intimation, and also we shall find, is also one of the last intimations.